Thank you for coming today to honor and remember Jerry Collins and to support his family in this time of their loss. It is not Jerry's loss. He has experienced great gain where he's at today. Jerry enjoyed Southern gospel music. Many of you know that. There were some songs that especially became meaningful to him in this last year or so. He'd asked for those to be played at this time. Believe that these will give you some insight into his heart and his thoughts as he moved towards his homegoing.
I like to think about a paradise somewhere beyond, the blue. A mansion waiting in the eastern sky, maybe next door, to you. We'll go parading the distant stars, right in the new Milky Way. The planets Jupiter, Neptune and Mars won't even be, halfway. Move up to glory land. Oh, yes, and move and sky. Don't know when I'm leaving, but I'm ready to go. When I get to heaven, I'll be welcome. I know. Don't you know, and move and move and move and move and move up to glory land. I made my reservations long ago, the day I gave up sin. And when my mansion ready, this I know I'm gonna move right in. I have a vision of a happy place where friends and loved ones meet. Right on the corner, of Flood Avenue and Hallelujah.
And Hallelujah.
Oh, do it pretty now, listen.
Move and move and move and move.
I love it.
Move up to glory land. Oh, it's a move and move and move.
Hey!
I said,
don't know when I'm leaving, but I'm ready to go. When I get to heaven, I'll be welcome, I know.
Don't you know,
move and move and move and move and move up to glory land. Move and move and move and move up to glory land.
Thank you very much.
Colors of the leaves, but the longer I stay here, the more I want to see the one who shed his sinless blood and gave his life for me.
I want to see Jesus and look into his eyes. I want to see his precious hands and feet and the scar in his side. I'll thank him for dying for a sinner like me. Only he'll call Golgotha on that old rugged tree.
happen. There's lots of amazing things. Mansions, walls, streets of gold, and the angels when they sing. But when I get to heaven, the first thing I want to see is the one who shed his sinless blood and gave his life for me.
I want to see Jesus and look into his eyes. I want to see his precious hands and feet and the scar in his side. I thank him for dying for a sinner like me. On a hill called Golgotha, on that old rugged tree. I'll thank him for dying for a sinner like me. On a hill called Golgotha, on that old rugged tree.
Yeah. just an old piece of clay.
This old house once knew my children, this old house once knew my wife. This old house was home and comfort as we fought the storms of life. This old house once rang with laughter, this old house heard many shouts. Now she trembles in the darkness when the night wind walks about. Ain't they gonna leave this house no longer, ain't they gonna leave this house no more.
Ain't got time
to fix the shingles,
ain't got time
to fix the floor.
Ain't got time
to oil the hinges,
nor to mend the
window pane.
Ain't they gonna leave this house no longer, I'm getting ready to say.
This old house is a-gettin' shaky, this old house is a-gettin' old. This old house lets in the rain, and this old house lets in the cold. On my knees I'm a-gettin' chilly, but I feel no fear of pain. Cause I see an angel peeking through a broken window pane. Ain't they gonna need this house no longer, ain't they gonna need this house no more.
Ain't got time
to fix the shingles,
ain't got
time to fix the floor.
Ain't got
time
to oil the hinges,
nor to mend the window pane.
Ain't they gonna need this house no longer, I'm getting ready to be the same.
Now my old hound dog lies asleeping, he don't know I'm gonna leave. Tells he'd wake up by the fireplace and he'd sit there and howl and grieve. But my hunting day's over, I ain't gonna hunt the coon no more. Gabriel hunted on in the chariot when the wind blew down the door. I ain't gonna need this house no longer, I ain't gonna need this house no more.
Ain't got time
to fix the shingles,
ain't got
time to fix the floor.
Ain't got time
to oil the hinges,
nor to mend the window pane.
Ain't gonna need this house no longer.
Yeah.
Ain't gonna need this house no longer.
Saints,
when the saints,
when the saints
marching,
go marching in,
in,
when the saints go marching in,
it would
want to be in that number. When the saints go marching in, when the saints go marching in, when the saints go marching in,
oh Lord, I
want to be in that number. When the saints go marching in.
Hard to follow that up. I feel I need to speak with a twang or speak deeper than I normally do. My name is Mark Stamper. I'm the assistant pastor here at Calvary Baptist Church, and it's been my delight and privilege to be with Jerry and to get to know him over the last 5.5 years. And I can definitely say that he had absolute delight in God and his ways, especially in his son, Jesus Christ. And I think those songs illustrated that. Let me open up this morning with prayer. Lord, we thank you that you have worked so mightily in Jerry's life. What a blessing he has been to us by seeing Jesus Christ work through him, and such an encouragement that he has been to our church family. And we will miss him, but Lord, we thank you that he is home in heaven with you. And may we take courage and comfort from his life and from his utter hope in Jesus Christ. May all that we do here this morning point to Jesus Christ through Jerry's life. In your name, amen. Gerald W. Jerry Collins, age 81 of Quincy, went home to be with his Lord and his Savior, Jesus Christ, on Sunday, May 1st, 2022, in his home, surrounded by his family. Jerry was born on October 21st, 1940, in Peoria, Illinois, the son of Gerald M. and Faye W. Golden Collins. He married Wilma Mae Davis on August 27th, 1960. She preceded him in death on June 25th, 2006, and he married Gloria Shriver Doherty on April 19th, 2008 at Calvary Baptist Church here in Quincy. Jerry loved the Lord, his family, and all things science related. He was a naturally inquisitive man who had a lifelong love of learning. Jerry grew up on a farm and went to high school in Mansfield, Illinois. He attended Olivet Nazarene College, received his bachelor's degree in electrical engineering from U of I, and earned his master's degree from the Florida Institute of Technology. He worked as an electrical engineer for Harris Broadcasting in Palm Bay, Florida, and in Quincy until his retirement in 1996. In retirement, Jerry taught at Quincy Christian School and at John Wood Community College. He held early patents in HDTV technology and was the author of Fundamentals of Digital Television. Sadly, I didn't know that, or I would have bought a copy and had him sign it. And this book is still used in universities today. Jerry was a dedicated Christian and was an active member of our church here at Calvary. He was involved with many ministries over the course of his life, including youth, music, missions, and he taught Sunday school for over 60 years. And I have to put a personal note in there. When Jerry had to retire from teaching Sunday school last year, I visited him, and he had an incredible pleasure in studying the Bible. He was ending in Romans chapter 11, and I don't know how long we talked about Romans 11, and you could just see a passion in him that he wished he could keep on teaching all the way through the end of the book of Romans. Jerry loved the Lord. Jerry was a ham radio enthusiast, and he traveled extensively. Survivors, in addition to his wife, include three daughters, Susan and David Wilson, of Farmer City, Illinois, Stephanie Boyer, and Cheryl and Rodney Hart, both of Quincy, two stepchildren, Pastor Tim and Jeremy Doherty, and Rochelle and Tim Manick, both of Quincy, 13 grandchildren, Lane Wilson, Emily and Brett Roos, Evan, Kristen and Brant Boyer, and their father, Randy Boyer, Hannah, Spencer and Andrew Collins, and their mother, Mindy Beckwith, Olivia, Kaylee, and Josh Doherty, and Elijah and Caleb Manick, their three great-grandchildren, Braden Boyer and Morgan and Ben Collins, a brother, Larry and Joanne Collins, a sister, Sharon and Mark Moore, and other relatives too numerous to list. Jerry was preceded in death by his parents, his first wife, Wilma Mae Collins, a son, Gerald W. J. Collins, Jr., and a granddaughter, Skylar Collins.
Well, we're here to celebrate the life of Jerry Collins, my dad, my mentor, and the spiritual head of our family. He lived for his life for the Lord, and he clearly communicated that his deepest desire was for his family and his loved ones to follow Jesus too. Dad lived a remarkable life. He was born in Peoria, and his parents accepted Jesus as Savior when he was 4 years old. Dad and his sibs, Larry and Sharon, were brought up on a farm in Mansfield. They attended the Farmer City Nazarene Church whenever the doors were open, had daily family devotions, and lived out their faith. Dad went to Olivet Nazarene University, it was then college, where he met my mother, Wilma. And she was there, as we all know, for her MRS degree, and she got that really quickly. After they married, Dad and Mom moved to Champaign, where he finished an engineering degree at the U of I, and where I was born. We moved to Melbourne, Florida, where he took a job with Radiation, which later was bought out by Harris, and he stayed with Harris his entire career. And Steph, Cheryl, and Jay were born there. We moved to Quincy in the mid-70s when Dad was transferred with Harris. Dad designed and built radio and TV station antennas around the United States and the world. He spent time physically at the top of the World Trade Center, the old one, and the Sears Tower, you know, the Willis Tower. He did contract work with NASA, but he never would tell us what he actually did there because it was under security clearance. Dad held patents on high-definition TV and wrote a technical book on the subject, which no one in the family has actually read. Dave and Cheryl made valiant attempts, and they, I think, have made it through the first chapter. When he retired, he continued to do consulting work for engineering. He taught at John Wood and Quincy Christian School. He also very much enjoyed his weekly breakfast meetings with friends from his work years. And I have to say, it was really good to meet so many of them last night at the visitation. Dad was a deep thinker and a lifelong learner. Over the years, he earned a master's degree, and then he went on to earn his professional engineering license, which is a very involved process, and it requires a multi-day test and the whole bit. He studied Greek and Hebrew, mainly because he wanted to make sure the Bible was properly translated, and he found out it was. He earned his ham radio's operator's license along with our brother Jay. Dad studied the Bible, science, genealogy, astronomy, and loved to debate and learn and grow. I have very vivid memories of heated theological discussions between my dad and my grandfather at family get-togethers. My husband David and dad spent many hours over the years debating science and theological issues. Dad was a very disciplined man. When he faced diabetes in his 50s, he eliminated sugar from his diet and he began exercising regularly. This was no small turnaround for a guy who was previously known in the neighborhood as the Cookie Man. He used to fill his pockets with cookies and eat them while he mowed the lawn. As his kidney issues progressed, he tracked his food on a spreadsheet, of course. Everything was a spreadsheet. And he tried to follow the required diet. This no doubt allowed him to avoid dialysis for as long as possible. He did the at-home version of dialysis, which, for those of you who know about that sort of thing, is no small feat and certainly a reflection of his discipline. Dad and Gloria faithfully exercised and enjoyed time at the Croc. They starred in a very cute commercial, which I don't know if you can find it online, where they are literally walking and holding hands, which is perfect. Dad was a spiritually disciplined man as well. He was the spiritual leader of our home growing up and in his home with Gloria. When my parents were married, he insisted that they have family devotions on their first night, on their wedding night, and they got up the next day and went to church. When he and Gloria began dating, they made sure they were accountable and above reproach, serving as godly examples for their children and grandchildren. As kids, we woke up every morning to see Dad kneeling by his chair in the living room, praying for us. That's your fault, Stephanie. I'm just going to say. We had family devotions every evening, though we kids were not always cooperative or respectful. Still, he persisted. Dad and Gloria continued to have devotions together right up to the end of his life. We're so grateful for Gloria being a godly wife and companion for Dad. I'm going to say this without looking at you, but Gloria, Tim, Rochelle, you and your families have been a blessing to us through all your time with Dad, and especially these past few years as his health declined. We thank you from the bottom of our hearts. So, Dad traveled extensively for work. We can't completely verify, but we think he was on all but one of the continents. And that love of travel continued into retirement. Dad and Gloria enjoyed nature and hiking, and they traveled together until it became too difficult for him to make the trips. Despite his work obligations over the years, Dad always made it a priority to be there for us when we needed him. I don't think he ever missed one of my high school band concerts or Steph's cheerleading. He supported Jay through his many health issues, me through my first marriage, which failed, the death of Cheryl's infant daughter, and so many other aspects of our lives and that of our children. Suffice it to say, we've put him through a lot. As a young man, Dad felt called by God to be a dedicated layman in the church, and he faithfully served in that capacity his whole life. He taught Sunday school for 60 years. I do not think that he was in Romans the whole time. Although I have to say, I can't honestly remember the last time I was in his class that he wasn't in Romans. He led the youth group in Melbourne. He helped with Awanas and Upward Basketball here in Quincy. He, of course, sang in the choir, led music, was a deacon, served on the mission committee, went on mission trips, and supported his church and pastors with his whole heart. With that booming, singing voice, you always knew when Jerry was in the house. So, in retirement, he served as a volunteer chaplain at Blessing Hospital and answered questions online for the Billy Graham Association's Search for Jesus program. I am sure that Sunday, when he passed away, he was welcomed into the arms of Jesus, where he was told, "Well done, good and faithful servant." That one's my fault. I wrote that. I do not want to convey that my dad was perfect, because he was not. And he was the first to say he was not. And then I was going to list all the ways he wasn't perfect, and I changed my mind on that. If you don't know, that's okay. On Easter Sunday, 2022, Dad uncharacteristically called a family meeting and told all of us girls he wanted us there by 5. I live 3 hours away. He told us that he had decided to stop dialysis and would be going on hospice. From the time of that announcement, he had many loved ones reach out to him. He told everyone who called or visited, including the hospice people, the nurses, anybody who stopped by, that at the end of life, you realize the most important things are, one, to have a relationship with Jesus Christ, and two, that you know God's word. Above all, he wanted each one of us to know Jesus and enjoy abundant life in Christ. Thank you for taking time today to celebrate the life of my dad and to celebrate our and to support our family as we go through this loss. We appreciate it.
At this time, we're going to sing two songs that meant a lot to Jerry. The first is "Come Thou Fount." And again, Jerry's love for God. You can't understand Jerry if you don't understand his love for Jesus Christ. And these two songs, "Come Thou Fount," and then after that, "God Leads His Dear Children Along," both of them explain and express Jerry's just admiration of Jesus Christ. So "Come Thou Fount," we'll sing two verses.
Come thou fount of every blessing, tune my heart to sing thy grace. Streams of mercy never ceasing, call for songs of loudest praise. Teach me some melodious sonnet, sung by flaming tongues above. Praise the mount I'm fixed upon it, mount of God's unchanging love. Oh, to grace how great a debtor daily I'm constrained to be. Let thy grace, Lord, like a fetter, bind my wandering heart to thee. Prone to wander, Lord, I feel it, prone to leave the God I love. Here's my heart, oh, take and seal it for thy courts above.
On this next song, two notes. First of all, on "God Leads Us Along," we're going to sing the first verse in the chorus, and then we'll sing two additional verses in a row and finish with the chorus. And I cannot help but sing this song, and I can hear Jerry singing this. I mean, I remember him singing this song so many times. I hope this is an encouragement to you.
and so sweet, God leads his dear children along. Where the water's cool flow bathes the weary one's feet, God leads his dear children along.
To those of you who know Jerry, the Word of God, and he loved the God of the Word. He greatly enjoyed studying and teaching and sharing the truth of the Bible. And the last portion of God's Word that he taught in his longtime Sunday school class here at Calvary, Maranatha, was the New Testament epistle to the Romans. Upon visiting Jerry recently, he said to me that he wanted Romans 8 preached at this time and place. Well, I've been looking at Romans 8 for a while. And you're going to join? No. I'm going to give you an overview. The overall theme of Romans 8 is the power of sanctification or the Holy Spirit in the life of the believer. If you broke it down point by point, you would see that first of all, in verses 1 through 11, there is emancipated living, free living in Christ. There is exalted living by the Spirit of God. There is expectant living. That's certainly one of the places that Jerry focused in Romans 8, 18 to 30. Exultant living wraps up the chapter. If you were to read through it, you would read of no condemnation, adoption, redemption, intercession, salvation. And the chapter closes out with no separation from the love of God in Christ. In visiting with the family and Stephanie specifically, I had to agree that what we should focus on today is this phrase, there is therefore now no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus. Jerry referred to that regularly these last couple weeks whenever we would visit with him, and he would refer to Romans 8. He would say, There is now therefore no condemnation. That was a significant truth to Jerry. And I wonder, do you understand why Jerry found this to be such an encouragement and a source of confidence toward the end of his life? I want to suggest, first of all, that Jerry understood that we are all sinners, and because we are sinners, we all deserve condemnation. In Romans chapter 5 and verse 12, we read, "Therefore, just as through one man, that man was Adam, sin entered the world, and death through sin, and therefore death spread to all men, because all have sinned." The apostle, by the Spirit of God, had really already made this point earlier in Romans. In Romans 3:23, that familiar verse that every Awana child knows, "For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God." Sin, not a fun subject, and yet it's a reality for every one of us. One of the last conversations that Jerry and I had, he started telling me, this is why God had to save me. And I, "Jerry, you don't need to tell me." But Jerry did embrace the fact that he was a sinner. It was not something that he shied away from or was embarrassed about, because that was the expression of the glory of God in his life, that God would save a sinner. You know, in Romans 5:15-16, we read this. "There is a great difference between Adam's sin and God's gracious gift. For the sin of this one man, Adam, brought death to all. But even greater is God's wonderful grace and his gift of the forgiveness of sin to many through this other man, Jesus Christ. The result of God's gracious gift is very different from the result of that one man's sin. For Adam's sin led not only to our sin, but led to condemnation for Adam's race. But God's free gift leads to our being made right with God, even though we are guilty of many sins." See, we all deserve condemnation. We are all under God's condemnation because we are sinners. And that's what Jerry knew and understood and wanted us to understand. Certainly that is not encouraging, but remember the verse that Jerry quoted often is, "There is therefore now no condemnation." There has been a change. There has been a transaction that has happened. See, Jerry knew that we could all receive God's free, gracious gift. Let's talk about that free gift and how we can be assured, like Jerry, of no condemnation. The free gift is identified in Romans 6:23. "For the wages of sin is death." That's the bad news. But the great and marvelous, amazing news is this: that the free gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Jesus Christ is the agency by which we gain eternal life. There is no other way. Jesus would say in John 14:6, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me." Back to Romans, though. Romans 5:8 tells us that God showed his great love for us by sending Jesus Christ to die for us while we were still sinners. And since we have been made right in God's sight by the blood of Christ, he, God, will certainly save us from God's condemnation. See, the death Jesus Christ died was in our place, taking our condemnation for sin, our penalty and punishment. And so as we go back to Romans 8 and pick it up, verse 3 says, "The law of Moses was unable to save us." The law of Moses was unable to save us. See, what Jerry would point out is that many people say, "I'm keeping the Ten Commandments." He would say, "God's word says that is not able to save you. Don't deceive yourself thinking you can be good enough, that you can keep enough of God's laws to outweigh your sin." So God did what the law could not do. What was that? He sent his own son in a body like the bodies of sinners. The incarnation. What we celebrate at Christmas, Jesus Christ coming as a man in human flesh. That's what Romans 8:3 is telling us. That God did that, and in that body, God declared an end to sin's control over us by giving his son, Jesus Christ, as a sacrifice for our sins. That's the free gift. See, it's paid for by Jesus Christ in his death on the cross, and it's available to us. Romans 5:2 says this, "Therefore, since we have been made right in God's sight by faith, by believing on the Lord Jesus Christ, we can have peace with God because of what Jesus Christ our Lord has done for us. Because of our faith, Christ has brought us into this place of undeserved privilege where we now stand." And listen to this last phrase and see if you can't capture how this encouraged Jerry. "And we confidently and joyfully look forward to sharing God's glory." That was the basis for Jerry's confidence, his hope, his expectation, and anticipation in those last days of his life. See, Jerry had believed on the Lord Jesus Christ, that he had come from heaven, was God in the flesh, had died on the cross to pay the penalty for Jerry's sins, had risen from the grave and lived victorious, interceding and waiting in heaven at God's right hand to welcome us home. You say, how can you be sure that's what Jerry believed? Jerry has left us some written records. Let me share a couple of those with you. In his memoirs, which his children all have copies of this, and I'm sure would be glad to share with you, Jerry wrote this, "The reader should understand that the first 9 years of my life were lived in the flesh, that is, as a sinner. Even though I was taken to church regularly, listened intently to my Sunday school teacher, sang the songs, and heard the sermons preached by our pastor and traveling evangelists, I had never trusted Christ as my Savior and asked him to forgive my sin. I tried to obey my parents and my teachers, but none of these things were sufficient to change my heart and make me into the person God wanted me to be. I needed Christ." "He, Jesus Christ, is my only hope for salvation. Only he could make me a child of God. On Wednesday, March 15th, 1950, we were having revival meetings every night at the Farmer City Church of the Nazarene with Brother Moore doing the preaching and Brother Chapman doing the special singing. I remember kneeling at the west end of the altar, and I remember leaving the service that night with a new joy in my heart, knowing that my sins were forgiven. I have no doubt that I was saved that night as a 9-year-old boy." There's something else that Jerry didn't write, but he dictated to his daughter Stephanie just a week and a half ago. It was to be given to his brother-in-law and sister, Mark and Sharon Moore, because his school, that Mansfield High School, was having a reunion. Jerry had been looking forward to going and seeing many old friends, but of course by that time he wasn't able to, and so he wanted to share something with them, and this is what he shared. "Please let them," the high school friends, "No, I am currently on hospice and homebound. And please share my testimony if you would. As the Apostle Paul says, the time of my departure is at hand. At least that's what the doctors are telling me. My greatest desire is to see all of you in heaven someday." I think he would be saying that to all of you here today as well. I am thankful for God's assurance that He has saved me from my sins, and that I know I'll see Him face to face when this life is over. I want to say this. If you do not know Jesus Christ, please yield to Him. He is looking for you. He loves you and wants you to yield to Him. He will be your shepherd and see you through it all. Signed, to our God and Father be glory forever and ever. The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ be with your spirit. Jerry. Is Jerry speaking to you today, desiring for you to understand the truth of the message of Romans 8 and salvation by faith in Jesus Christ alone? See, for those of us who know what Jerry knew, and we've embraced Jesus Christ as our Savior by faith, we grieve today, but not as those without hope. We have a great expectation, and that is to be reunited with Jerry someday at the foot of Jesus, worshiping and praising, entering His glory, and seeing Him face to face. But if you have never made the decision to accept and receive Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, you are under condemnation. You are under the judgment of God, and you will not someday enter heaven being reunited with Jerry at the feet of Jesus. That is a very serious matter. Jerry wants you to understand that today. He desires for you to be saved and have the hope and assurance of heaven that carried him along each day, especially those days at the end. Our gracious Father in heaven, thank you for the truth of your word and your servant, Jerry Collins, who loved your word and loved you. Lord, he spent his life studying and teaching and sharing the truths of your word, and even now, Lord, desired that the truth of your word go out and be heard by all who would gather to remember him. May we understand this source of his hope and expectation and even joy. And may we embrace Jesus Christ ourselves. Thank you, Father, for hearing this prayer, the desire of Jerry's heart, his whole life. In Jesus' precious and holy name, amen. At this time, Pastor Mark is going to come and lead us in a couple other songs that Jerry wanted us to sing, to reflect upon. I'll be available after the service. Pastor Mark will as well. If you have some questions about what Jerry believed, what Jerry wanted you to understand here today, please come and talk with us. We would love to share with you Jerry's understanding of the truth and his relationship with Jesus.
We'll sing two more songs that meant a lot to Jerry. First of all, I Need Thee Every Hour, and then second, Great Is Thy Faithfulness.
Every hour. I come to thee.
Concludes our time together here. In a few moments, the funeral directors are going to come and dismiss you, and we'll make our way to Greenmount Cemetery for a brief time of committal. If you are not planning to come to the committal, that's fine. You're welcome to stay here. Downstairs, there will be a meal served when the family returns, and you're welcome to join them there.